Hey there guys, Paul here. In this video, I'm going to be walking you through some examples for the selection of solenoid valves for refrigeration applications. Coming up, selecting a solenoid valve, checking a solenoid valve's performance for different operating conditions, generating a report, and generating a bill of materials. This video is part of a series where we'll be looking at a number of worked examples using the Coolselector 2 application to help you select and calculate components for your refrigeration system. So do check out the other videos if you haven't already. Links are in the video description below. Solenoid valves are commonly used in all refrigeration applications. An important aspect of selecting solenoid valves in Coolselector 2 is to distinguish between the functionality and the valve family. The valves in Coolselector 2 are classified based on the functionality they are used for. Solenoid valve functionality is to open and shut off the flow in a line. For example, an ICM valve can be used as an expansion valve, a control valve, or a slow opening solenoid valve. However, each of these functionalities results in a different consideration for the selection and calculation. We should always use the proper functionality to choose the valve so that we get the relevant required information to make a good decision. We start the selection process for the solenoid valve by first selecting the Valves and Line Components tab and then selecting the solenoid valve option. We begin in the left-hand panel by first selecting the system type. In this case, we'll use a dry system. We can then select where in the system the valve will be installed using the system schematic. In this case, we require a solenoid valve in the liquid line to be installed before the expansion valve for safety reasons. Next, we choose the refrigerant our system will use. We'll choose R513A from the drop-down menu for this example. We can also choose the connection type, but for this example, I'll leave this as all. The Products Families table lists all the available products. We can hover our mouse over these titles to see a small photo as well as a brief product description. After specifying the system and the refrigerant, we must first input our operating conditions before selecting a solenoid valve family. To do that, we head to the top center panel. We'll set a cooling capacity of 45 kilowatts. An evaporation temperature of 0 degrees Celsius with a useful superheat of 4 Kelvin. Then we'll set a condensation temperature of 42 degrees Celsius with a subcooling of 2 Kelvin. Then we can select the family of the solenoid valves. You can see some of the families are highlighted in red. These are the families which are not officially released for R513A. However, Coolselector 2 provides the calculations for them. And if you are interested in using them in your system, you should contact your Danfoss supplier for further information. You can check the refrigerant's compatibility with product families in Tools, Products and Refrigerants Overview. We've covered this aspect in detail within our Tools and Preferences video. Do check that out, links are in the video description below. For this case, we want to install an EVR V2, so we choose that among the listed families. We can then set our selection criteria, but for this example, I'll leave this as default. The screen will now refresh to display the product data. The table lists a number of solenoid valves. Some valves are listed with red text. This is warning us that there is a compatibility issue with our system and operating conditions. In the rightmost column, we can view the warning by placing our mouse over the warning symbol. Alternatively, when we select one of these products, the warning message will display above the table. As we scroll down, we see a row highlighted in green. This is the suggested product which the application has calculated as most applicable to our system. This product is only a suggestion though, and you should check the performance details at different operating conditions to ensure it's compatible with your system. To check the performance details, we head to the lowest panel of the window. Under the Performance Curve tab, we find an interactive graph plotting the pressure drop against load for the selected valve. The values change as we move our mouse across the graph. When selecting a solenoid valve, we should always check the valve performance details to make sure the valve would operate properly at different conditions. This is very important since based on the design and the type of solenoid valve, we should pay attention to different details for our selection. For example, in the EVR V2 family, there are three types of valves. If we change our cooling capacity to 4.5 kilowatts, we see the performance curve for the revised suggested solenoid valve has no lower limit. This is because this is the direct solenoid valve which can open and close completely, regardless of the capacity. If we change it back to our original capacity of 45 kilowatts and click on the suggested product, we can see the performance curve has a lower limit. We can see here that the valve is not suitable for an application lower than 39.5 kilowatts, and in our case, that's 87% of the nominal load. This is because the selected solenoid valve is a diaphragm solenoid valve which requires a certain pressure drop across the valve to open. If our system will need to operate lower than this, then this valve will not be suitable and we should select another. Another important factor is the operating conditions over different periods of the year. If in our case the winter temperature of the condenser is 15 degrees Celsius, we can see that the suggested valve would not function properly. This can result in higher load on the compressor or increase the condensation pressure during winter time, and hence increasing our costs and decreasing the energy efficiency. If we increase our load to 450 kW and select the suggested valve, we can see that it again has a different performance curve. This is because this is a servo piston operated solenoid valve. A servo piston operated valve requires a minimum pressure drop to open initially, and then as the pressure drop rises, it starts opening further until it reaches a pressure drop which can open the valve completely. It is usually no problem to run in the yellow area where the valve is partially open, but we should consider this for our selection. For this example, let's assume we need a valve to operate between 40 and 100% load. That means we need a valve capable of handling between 25 kW and 45 kW at 15 degrees condensation in winter to 42 degrees in the summer conditions. Let's change our cooling capacity to 25 kW and our condensation temperature to 15 degrees to have the minimum pressure drop across the valve in the winter conditions. Now we see that the EVR10V2 is suggested, and in the graph we see that it can handle this cooling load at winter conditions. If we then keep this product selected and change our cooling capacity back to 45 kW and the condensation temperature to 42 degrees, we also see this valve is capable of handling our full load of 45 kW, so we will select this valve. If we head to the Performance Details tab in the lowest panel of the window, we can find thermodynamic data for the system and product, as well as a system schematic and even a pressure enthalpy chart. In the Code Number Selection tab, we can find product-specific code numbers for the various connection types. We can generate a report for our selected products simply by clicking on the Report button in the top menu bar. The window will then refresh to display our product report. In the left-hand panel under Items to Include in the Report, we can add or remove information from our report by clicking on the plus button and then selecting or unselecting the item. If we make a change here, simply click the Update button at the top to apply these changes. Additionally, we have the option to add a project name, some comments, as well as an author name to the report using the inputs on the top left-hand panel. Again, if you make a change here, then simply click the Update button to apply these. Along the top of the report, we also have various options to export the report. We can generate a bill of materials which can be provided to a Danfoss supplier to obtain a quotation by clicking on the Bill of Materials button in the top menu bar. Here the product quantity, product description and the code numbers will be displayed. In the left-hand panel, we also have the option to add a project name, some comments, as well as an author name using the inputs. If you make a change here, then just click the Update button to apply this. Along the top of the Bill of Materials, we also have a number of buttons to export the Bill of Materials. Okay, that's it for this video. Thank you very much for watching. We hope you've enjoyed this and it has helped you. If so, then please don't forget to like, subscribe, and share. If you have any questions at all, let us know in the comments section down below. You can also find links to more Coolselector tutorials in the video description. Do check those out, and once again, thanks for watching.